In this edition of Art Loft, the conclusion of my meditation.
A lot of my work is kind of meditation based, even though I don't like try to make it that way. I like incorporating science and mysteries because I think mysteries are so beautiful and I want that to come across in my artwork.
Art under the oaks.
About 32 years ago, this art festival started as strictly fine art. And it ran like that for many years, but over time, they found that people were looking for other types of art as well.
And Pan-African Arts.
I'm an African musical instrument maker. So I do instrument making workshops, lecture demonstrations of the musical instruments, and I conduct lectures of African linguistic retentions.
They are somewhat of this world, but then twisted and somewhat not of this world.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from Ricard Gallery in Wynwood, this is Art Loft. First up tonight, we connect with another Miami artist profiled during the Chicago Project X. Wet Heat Project documents Jen Stark's meditative creative process. Here, Stark crafts mind-bending, ascending works that just might prompt calls for a replay. Enjoy.
The joy of this day is shared by many. The extraordinary group of curators and artists who believed that the arts initiative was important, and ultimately they made it so. Thank you for the incredible talents that each of you has brought to this day.
A lot of my work is kind of meditation based, even though I don't like try to make it that way. I like incorporating science and mysteries because I think mysteries are so beautiful and I want that to come across in my artwork. It's very freeing to be able to go crazy on a wall and not have to like abide by, you know, your sketch or like, this has to be here and this has to be here. I want to do this, but I want it to just drip all over the escalator and sort of take it over. And they, you know, the Arts Initiative was like, do it. Just do whatever you want. Go for it. And I'm like, all right, I'll do it. Right now, penciling in big psychedelic waterfall.
When the windows won't let you out, you'll stop. The water. Just so petrified by heavy drops of rain, never stopping their fall. The trace of the moon, it's a magnet to pull you on. So sail far away from the lonely light.
So the finished sculpture will hang in between these two floors. It'll be sort of like this colorful wormhole, and when you're standing at a certain point, you can look up inside of it and you'll see like this crazy rainbow gradient tunnel. It's all white right now, but I'm going to paint each layer a different color. There's 48 layers in total. It'll be like one solid color each ring. The sculptures and the murals are just the conclusion of my meditation.
Even though you're not like me.
To see more of Stark's work, visit jenstark.com. And for more from Wet Heat Project, visit wetheatproject.com.
Here are gourd, netted gourd rattles, and these are called shekere. And this particular rattle originates among the Yoruba people of Nigeria.
Next, we head down to Plantation Key for the 32nd annual Art Under the Oaks Fine Arts and Crafts Fair. On the oak-shaded grounds of San Pedro Catholic Church in Tavernier, over 100 artists congregate with art lovers during this beloved Florida Keys event.
This is our 32nd year of holding Arts and Crafts Festival. About 32 years ago, this art festival started as strictly fine art. And it ran like that for many years, but over time they found that people were looking for other types of art as well. And so they started adding into it arts and crafts and food vendors, and as a result it has grown and become much more popular. This year we're pleased to announce that we have 145 vendors participating in our event. We have a huge variety of vendors. We have artists. They work in oil, they work in watercolor, acrylics. We have photographers who bring their work. We have crafters, we have quilt makers, we have plants. We have some food items like honey. We have handmade soaps and candles. Just about any kind of craft or artwork that you can think of, we have here. We have a few things happening during the day that you might want to be aware of. We have a raffle, which is a very popular event. Just about every vendor donates a piece of art or crafts to the raffle. And so that means somewhere around 145 items are going to be raffled out, so your chances are good. And that is held throughout the day. There's also what we call the world famous Women's Club bake sale. And every type of goodie that you could ever want to buy is there available to purchase. Generally, the people that come year to year, they're so excited when they get off the bus because they know exactly where they're going, they know vendors that they'd like to visit again, and they say when they run into me on the streets that they're so excited, they've already got it marked off on their calendars. And then the new people that we see, they generally come up and give us feedback that is positive, and we hope that they'll come back year after year as well.
For more info about this event, visit artundertheoaks.com.
Always been an artist, was always a creative kid. I did attend the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, but I feel that most of my training has come from researching other artists, talking to other artists, experimenting.
There were so many talented artists at Art Under the Oaks 2015. In the coming weeks, we'll introduce you to some we met. This week, meet Eddie Osborne. In addition to delivering lectures on African linguistic retention, Osborne is an accomplished craftsman. Join us as we stumble upon a jam session using his handcrafted African instruments.
I had learned about Art Under the Oaks about 10, 15 years ago. It just blew me away. It's a very good event. I'm very impressed with it. It's well organized. And usually when I come, there's no rain. I'm an African musical instrument maker. So I do instrument making workshops, lecture demonstrations of the musical instruments, and I conduct lectures of African linguistic retentions. What I have here today are basically my musical instruments, mostly percussive instruments. Here are gourd, netted gourd rattles, and these are called shekere. And this particular rattle originates among the Yoruba people of Nigeria. The plucked instrument, the one that's played with the finger, with the thumbs or fingers, is called thumb piano. That's a misnomer. That instrument is most commonly known in this country by the name kalimba. Two of my xylophones are gourd resonated. The bala, which is found in Guinea, Mali, Senegal, and another type called jil. And I make a box kind called madinda. And madinda is a word that's related to marimba, because the marimba itself actually came from Eastern Africa to the Americas. The crafting of a particular instrument, it depends on the instrument. For example, I can make a shekere in about 4 hours if it's just a netting. And a thumb piano I can make in a couple of hours, a simplified one. I've gotten a lot of positive feedback. So I had a little impromptu jam with a young lady who came in earlier. She was really entranced by the so-called thumb piano.
For additional information on Osborne's instrument making workshops and cultural presentations, visit ancestralmemory.com.
I'm down here participating in the Paradise Paint Out in Isla Mirada. I have never been to the Keys before, and so all the more I wanted to participate in this event. Of course, where I'm from, it's freezing now. So what's not to like?
I've heard a variety of ways my work is described. Some people say that it's scary, which I don't agree with. There tends to be a little bit of a dark edge to a lot of my compositions. Some people say whimsical, playful, colorful, surreal. There are somewhat of this world, but then twisted and somewhat not of this world.
Working from a studio in a riverside home, Amy Kolar Anderson uses a paintbrush to bring to life people and places that seem familiar, but also contain elements of the unknown, the bizarre, the alien.
I've always been an artist, was always a creative kid. I did attend the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, but I feel that most of my training has come from researching other artists, talking to other artists, experimenting. I learned with oils, but the slow dry time, all the toxic solvents, they just weren't my favorites. With acrylics, you don't have any of that. You know, I can do a layer of paint and within 10 minutes, I'm working on top of it as opposed to 24 hours with the oils. Acrylics also have all sorts of mediums. There's interference paints, metallics, neons, just a lot of crazy textures and colors that I like to play with.
In addition to her playful use of color and materials, Amy uses her canvases to create characters and tell stories, finding inspiration in a variety of places.
There's always these layers of narration and character development and such. One of my recent series was based on the writings of Lewis Carroll and his Alice in Wonderland books. And so I read the books, researched the characters, and created drawings that I then transferred to the canvas. It was a lot of preparation, a lot of pre-planning. And then sometimes I'm inspired by dreams. Sometimes working in the yard, I'll get an idea. Sometimes life events or stories on the news. Inspiration can come from anywhere. And I like that variety. I don't want to just make the same thing all the time. I like the challenge of new directions and new materials. As far as completing a painting, it takes anywhere from, 50 hours to 200 hours, depending on the size and the level of complexity. I do have a YouTube channel. I've been posting time-lapse videos. I've learned through trial and error to set up the camera, and the timer goes off every minute. So I've had a lot of fun playing with time in there, whether it's showing parts of the window in the frame or showing my cats flipping and flopping as they sleep or showing clocks tick away the minutes. It actually helps the paintings move a little bit quicker even, which is strange because it just keeps me focused.
Amy's paintings have been exhibited in galleries and juried shows throughout Ohio and across the United States. In the winter of 2014, she created a series of entirely new works for Identification, a solo show at Art Street Studio D Gallery on the University of Dayton campus.
I was asked by Brian LaDuca, the director of Art Street, to participate. This year's theme in general was on human rights. So Brian and I talked about what directions the show could take. And that's when I decided I wanted my show to be about empathy and just connecting with other people. There were six paintings in the show, and those were more of the internal sort of looking inward. The palette was also very, very different from what I've normally done. My work had been very loud, and in some cases a little obnoxious, a little flashy. And this work was very quiet and soft, lots of grays and muted blues and silvers. So it was just a lot quieter. There were two face panels on either side of the gallery space, and I had the faces of family members, loved ones, friends, people that I've had really great conversations with. Basically, the faces would transition down into pebbles, and then the pebbles would go across the floor. The pebbles represented sort of the nameless, faceless other. And as they transitioned into the people that you know and love, they go from being these elements that you can ignore and pretend aren't there to elements that you would do anything for. So in the center of the gallery, we had the interactive workstation, and I created these canvas pebbles that people could draw or write on any sort of situation where they've learned empathy or whatever they wanted to talk about that tied into that idea with connecting with others. So it was really exciting to see the piece evolve throughout the month and see these pebbles multiply, and they were able to sort of shift and turn and just sort of dance in the space. It was very meditative, and I really enjoyed how it came together.
Originally a native of the Chicago area, Amy moved to Dayton in the 1990s. Since then, she's developed strong ties within the local art scene and now finds herself playing a special role for a company that's part of the city's reinvention.
Dayton has been growing and changing over the last 18 years. Warped Wing Brewery is one of the newest breweries in town. I'm considered their official brewery artist, and I do all the specialty beer designs. It's been fun working with the guys and doing a little more graphic work. With these Warped Wing projects, I'm using some of those skills of the graphic design, but I'm not approaching it like it's a graphic design project. These are works of art. It's very exciting to be a part of it and get to taste the final product at the end. How all the visions and concepts and everything kind of come together.
Thanks for joining us this week. Remember, you can visit wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. Also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtloftSFL. I'm Kaylin James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye. Ow, ow, bam, got it, got it. I'm sure some of that is Super Bowl leftover, I just can't get right. Keep your feet quiet, Lance.
You got sand, you know.
I know.
That Tuesday sand is
super. I know! Sorry, I'll bring it up. Ready? So we head down to Plantation Key. Sorry. Plantation Key. I messed up. I'm again with ding 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 ding. Ugh, that was painful.
I'm sorry? Never
mind. We're working, Lance. We don't have time for your frivolity over there.
I heard your blue light.
Visit ancestralmemory.com. Excuse me. Yes, please. May I have a sippy whippy? I think that's a wrap, folks. Yay!
Nice job.
Thank you.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.